Haiku is the shortest form of poetry in the world, with roots dating back over 1,200 years. Photographs capture that one single moment. The two worlds meet to create a new form of visual literature. A beautiful and profound world. Haiku is the world's shortest form of poetry, which captures the subtleties of everyday life in just 17 sounds. A photograph is much the same. It is an art form that also captures the beauty of everyday life. The two working together expands our imagination to an entirely new level. That is the world of photo haiku. Taking a dive. Body falls faster, dragging the soul behind. You need to be a trained athlete in order to take a dive from an elevated platform. The entire dive may last but a few seconds. The speed is amazing, and so I thought the human soul could never catch up. It is truly remarkable what people can feel and perceive. There are no limits. We are here today at Koishikawa Kouraku-en Gardens, where haiku poets often gather to read haiku poems. This pine tree was planted here in this garden as an homage to Basho's haiku.
Hi, konnichiwa. Konnichiwa.
Nakahara-sensei, Kit, it's nice to see you again.
It's nice to see you again, too.
Yeah. Awesome. Here we are in the Koishikawa Kouraku-en Gardens, as you can see.
It all feels very familiar. I grew up in a place like this, where I was surrounded by trees and nature.
And by the way, Kit,
yes.
So the first time, this is our first episode of this program.
Yes.
We'd like to learn a little bit about you. How did you get into haikus? What is your history in this poetry?
It's a little hard to believe, but my grandfather gave me a book of haiku when I was 6 years old.
When you were 6 years old?
I was just learning to read. And he said, if you're going to learn to read something good. And it sunk in, and it's odd, but haiku is one of the few poetry forms that even a child can understand, I think.
Yeah. Recently, like with our program, Photo Haikus, you know, we're taking photos and haikus, putting them together. What do you think is most appealing about this kind of art form of taking photo and applying haikus to them and the other way around?
I know many people who work in shahai, where haiku is not just a description of the photo. The photo and the haiku are both independent works of art, but when the two meet, it creates an entirely new sensation.
Well, it's extremely appealing because it allows people many different ways to access the artwork. Some people are visual, some people are oral, some people don't really, they're scared of poetry, so the photograph sort of invites them in to experience the total artwork. But then again, it's a photograph with writing that have to work together in some way. Not complement each other necessarily, but to add information mm-hmm. to each element. It's actually quite tricky to do it. I don't think it's as easy as people think.
Okay, so our topic, our theme of photo haikus, it's actually kind of a difficult theme in a way, because we're not trying to make haikus that describe the photo, mm-hmm. and we're not trying to make photos that are related to the haiku. It's kind of, they need to resonate with each other, I believe. So to show that, we have an example. So I'll read the haiku right now. Crumpled handkerchief at the bottom of the garbage, her tears of yesterday. Crumpled handkerchief at the bottom of the garbage, her tears of yesterday.
The world's crumpled handkerchief really stood out to me at first glance, and I initially thought that the author was talking about the vibrant energy of the flower getting ready to bloom. However, you read on to see the word tears, and it made me realize that there must be a meaning in the handkerchief being red, as you see in the picture, instead of a plain white handkerchief. So, in my mind, I started to imagine red tears. In Japanese, there's a word called korui, which literally means red tears, which are the tears shed when a person is overcome with grief. But on the other hand, red tears also signify a young, beautiful woman. So the words, her tears of yesterday, really speak to me of the sadness this woman must have been feeling.
So I guess looking at the photo in itself, it's a whole different, you put them together, they resonate with each other in a very, I guess, in a new way. It mm-hmm. gives you something new to look at. What do you think, Kit, when you saw this, when you read this haiku, when you see this photo?
I felt many of the things that Sensei has said as well, and I thought that there's a passion to it that's extraordinary. The poem itself would seem simply sad and kind of gray, but the photograph adds some vitality to it to suggest that this is an ongoing passion, and I really liked that very much. And again, this is a poem that calls on texture. Mm-hmm. Crumpled handkerchief, and we might rush right past that and think simply, okay, that's the past situation of the handkerchief. But when you look at the flower, you sense that texture, mm-hmm. the feeling that crushes suddenly like that, and yet might open again. Mm-hmm. So there's some possibility for a revival of the relationship, which is nice.
Yeah, it's...
Haiku is an extremely short form of poetry, using only 17 sounds or morai, so it is in essence incomplete. So the photo, resonating with the haiku from its own viewpoint, really brings out a new world which then resonates with our hearts. The synergy is what makes this interesting.
That's the magic, the power of photo haikus. They come together, resonate. The synergy creates something new. Yeah, I totally agree.
Perfect.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to ask Nakarese to, I guess go into a little more, describe the guidelines that we have.
As I mentioned earlier, we would like to somehow maintain the original form or rhythm of haiku. which is 17 morai divided into three phrases of 5, 7, and 5. This traditional form creates a certain rhythm that has been a part of the Japanese culture for a very long time. For example, the rhythm you often hear at festivals in Japan, Dodongadon, is a rhythm that you don't hear in Latin America or Africa. It is a rhythm used in Bonodori, or the Bone Festival dance, and much like the 5-7-5 rhythm in breath, it is a rhythm that the Japanese are very comfortable with. But when written in English, the same rhythm and logic may not apply, and thus, I think it might be better to just have a guideline which says the haiku need only be written in three lines.
We have that in English too. Iambic pentameter is a rhythm often used in poetry, but 5-7-5 seems to work best in Japanese, I guess.
So for Nagara-sensei, you would say that one of our guidelines is to kind of keep it in the three-line form. How about you, Kate? Like, what are your...
Of course, you know, there are lots of modern haiku, or they're called haiku, that have a single line, and the Japanese used to be written in a single line. So there's some reasoning behind that, and sometimes two lines. Two lines are very popular right now, sometimes one word. But when you're doing photo haiku, it may make sense to do it in three lines, because then it doesn't look like a caption or an advertising poster or something.
I see.
So it lets you know, it signals that this is a poem if you have it in three lines. So I think that's a good guideline.
Yeah, definitely. And one thing I want to ask you, Kit, because haiku is a very Japanese form, is the goshichigo, the 5-7-5, the rhythm. But it's been like I learned it when I was in middle school. You were introduced to haiku when you were 6 years old. What is the history of haiku in America, or overseas in the States?
Well, the history of haiku in English goes back about 100 years. Haiku itself didn't really gain any kind of strong recognition among poets until the 1950s, I think it was. Three very serious scholars, Henderson, Blythe, and Yasuda, published important works on haiku, and these covered the history of haiku, had translations, and some of them included original works by these scholars. That just lit a fire under poets in the United States in particular, like Gary Snyder, for example.
And I was like the beat movement, like I always think of Kerouac and the minimalist movement. It's very, ties into that, I guess, culture. Is that a correct...
Absolutely.
Okay, so I guess the biggest thing we've learned from the history of haiku in America and just haiku in general is it's simplicity, and it makes it very easy to, I guess, get into. And I think that translates well into photo haikus because, for one, it's photos. Everyone takes photos. And the haiku itself is a very simple, very short medium. And putting those together, I think it makes it even more appealing, more accessible to more people around the world. And do you think the same?
Everyone can take photographs. Everyone can take photos of oceans, rivers, and flowers, but each person can express it in their own individual way. You don't want to give a straight description of the photo. You want to express the emotions that surround that photo. And when you do that, each photo haiku will become a completely different expression. That's what's interesting, and that is what will give the work its individuality. The originality of the work is what interests me the most. With photo haiku, you do not want to give a straight description of the photo. You want to express the thoughts or emotions that surround that moment in a three-line form. For example, you see this beautiful pine tree in front of us, but what is most important is that you do not simply describe the beautiful pine tree in your photo haiku. People already see the tree in the photo, and so mentioning it again, you are limiting yourself, perhaps losing out on expressing something that is much more significant. The image that you want to keep in mind is a river with just the right width. There's a phrase in Japanese which explains this concept called fusoku furi.
How do you translate that?
Well, that's a tough one, but that's one of our guidelines, right?
Right.
So for the photo haiku, so we started off.
Not too far, not too close.
Not too close. So, since we're outside in the beautiful park here, the garden, and the sky is blue, it's a great weather, you know, spring is coming, I'd like to bring out a photo haiku. That is kind of, it relates to today. There's a...
And we have perfect weather.
Exactly. So it's beautiful. Okay, so first I'd like to get your opinion on this, Nakano-sensei. How would you take this photo haiku? Start to fly, picturing a dream, high into the sky. Start to fly, picturing a dream, high into the sky.
I think the haiku is more a description of the photo than not. You already see the blue sky, so I don't think you need to say it outright. Why not replace it with other words to give it a different dimension? Photos always have something that they lack, for example, sounds. Photos do not express sounds.
Would that also be, I guess, like sound, but also touch,
sure,
taste?
Touch, taste, smell.
So,
yes, smell. That is another thing that a photo cannot express.
Yeah, even just onomatopoeia, sound would be nice too.
Yes, so let's all try to include those types of elements in our photo haiku.
Okay.
The deafening noise, I pretend surprise and squeeze her hand. The deafening noise, I pretend surprise and squeeze her hand.
You don't see it in the photo, but in conjunction with the haiku, you can picture the two holding each other's hands.
I love the pretend part.
Yeah.
Because everybody has to have some little trick to get somebody's attention.
Yeah.
And to show their passion. That's so charming.
Oh, there is.
I love it.
Yeah.
The photo all of a sudden becomes something that is more familiar. Adding an element that you don't see, you achieve a different dimension. I think this was a great example of soku hudi. The picture and haiku are not too close, but not too far apart. So always make sure to write about the emotions that surround the photo.
For example, the other day, I do this almost every day.
Right.
I took a photograph and I thought of a haiku to put in there. Offering coins to those in need, spring's windfall. Offering coins to those in need, spring's windfall. What I'm thinking when I wrote that is that when we're walking through spring, the petals that are falling are kind of like a gift, and we are the people in need of that gift in the spring. We've gone through a long winter, and we desperately need some donation from spring. So you collect these little coins and put them in your pocket, and you can save them all through the following winter. Oh, then I have a question to ask. Would you guys both be willing to use this photograph and maybe make a haiku in this space here?
Yes, I can manage.
Just throw it to us. But it was very interesting to take someone else's photo and put our own, I guess, haiku to it.
That's this is exciting for me to hear what you thought of it.
Yeah.
Yes, it was quite an honor.
So honored, it's an honor. Okay. What lies beyond this polka dot sky, oh my curious eyes? What lies beyond this polka dot sky, oh my curious eyes?
Well, I think that the polka dots is lovely, and your curious eyes is another nice way of putting how you look at the world. And polka dots brings to mind some girl's spring skirt, and I'm sure that's probably how you look at the world. So it has a freshness and a youth to it, and I like it that it's not you that are curious, but your eyes that are curious. Your eyes are outside of you, moving around, whether you like it or not. And there's something very charming about that.
I think that there is quite a distance from the photo itself. He stepped outside of himself and saw the photo through two different sets of eyes, or perhaps even more. And that is something I would never have thought of doing.
So just to what I was thinking when I made this, so with the hand reaching down into the, the petals are, they look to me like polka dots. And it's, although the hand is reaching down to grab the, to look into the, to have the petals fall down, I kind of took it the other way and said, like, the hand's reaching up into, like, a sky to see what's beyond. There's a little dark patch, which you don't really know what's in there, but it seems like the hand's reaching into that darkness to see what's over there. And it's not because you're trying, but your eyes, it sees it and it wants to go there. So that's how I was, that was the state of mind that I was in when I wrote this.
Well, often when something falls, you want to see where did it fall from, so you would naturally look.
I think his perspective is quite impressive. These individual views are what makes photo haiku so interesting.
Well then, okay, so after mine, we got to hear.
Yes.
Mr. Nakahara-sensei's photo haiku. Would you like to share it with us?
Quarrels, always after spring's second wind. Quarrels, always after spring's second wind.
What I focused on first were the fallen flower petals, and from there, I felt the rushing wind. The wind to me, in this instance, symbolizes the little quarrels that married couples have. And those quarrels are what scatter the flower petals like the wind. In Japan, we have what is called Haru Ichiban, which means the first spring storm, and it is the first and strongest wind signaling the coming of spring. Haru Niban is the second and lighter wind which follows, and it signals a warmer and more spring-like climate. I think that the relationship in a marriage works in the same way, where there is a strong wind that blows over, followed by a lighter second wind, which then brings a warmer and much more comfortable spring. That is the image I had in mind.
That's really, really wonderful. Wow.
I think it's really interesting how we all have different takes on the same photo, and they're very different.
Yes, so don't ever say, I can't. Always think, I need to do this in order to bring my own perspective into this world.
I think we should encourage that as much as possible, of course. I love it that in schools they require you to learn haiku, to give it a try. But when you become an adult, you have a whole different world of ideas in your mind, and you shouldn't give up then either.
You get to live life every day with a different thought and with a different perspective, so it's a lot of fun.
Part of the park, and it's, you know, spring is coming.
It's lovely, isn't it?
And I remember one of the most important parts of haikus are the seasonal words.
Kigo
in Japanese. But so they must also be really important in photo haikus, but how should we approach them?
If you take a look around, the first kigo that comes to mind is ume, or Japanese plum. But there is another kigo, umebyori, which is also appropriate. Umebyori describes a day such as this one in spring, where the weather and temperature are just right for the ume to blossom. Photo haiku is much the same. You don't have to take a photo of something that literally resembles spring, nor do you have to use a kigo, such as spring or ume, in your three-line haiku.
So I want to ask Nagara-sensei, if you take out the seasonal words, the kigo, in the photo haiku, what's the difference? What changes in the work?
If you include a kigo in your photo haiku, there is a lot that you can describe about that season. For example, the temperature or weather. So by using the kigo, it will free up space for you to use words to describe other things. I think the most important aspect about the kigo is that you can easily relate to it.
So, Nagara-sensei, I didn't really include a certain seasonal word or kigo in my three-line haiku. So when you look at that, like, did I need to add like a kigo in my haiku to make it better?
The photograph shows fallen flower petals, which hints of the end of spring. Furthermore, I think that the word curiosity is also acting as a kigo. Spring is the awakening, and when one awakens, curiosity is born. Therefore, the word curiosity also speaks of spring. So my answer to your question is no. I do not think that you need to add a kigo, as you have already amply expressed spring in your photo haiku. We are speaking here today from our viewpoint of living in Japan, but there are many wonderful places and seasons all around the world. So people outside of Japan just need to pay attention to seasonality in their own countries. Through photo haiku, I think that you will be able to make new discoveries and things that you may have overlooked in your everyday life. See things in your own way, and you will find that normality is not so normal anymore. There is nothing more exciting. Thank you all for watching Haiku Masters. Please stay connected by submitting your photo haiku through our website. You may be our next Haiku Master.